So I'm Heather McElroy. I'm the Natural Resource Program Manager here at the Cape Cod Commission. And very glad to have you all joining us here today. I'm going to give a little bit of an overview of this project and introduce our consultant and partner on this project, Joe Famely, to present much of the analysis piece of our presentation today. And then we'll get into a discussion about what you know about low-lying roads in town and your reactions to what you've heard here today. So just starting off with this project, this is a workshop on low-lying roads in the town of Dennis. Cape Cod Commission is working with the Woods Hole Group to analyze low-lying roads in 10 towns across the Cape. And why can I not see my, oh, here it is. Okay, sorry about that. So the purpose of our workshop here today is to review some flood projections that the Woods Hole Group has produced using a model and the impacts of those flood projections on roadways in the town under different future flooding scenarios. Then we're going to discuss the vulnerable low-lying roads or other transportation infrastructure that have been identified through these flood projections. And with the goal of ultimately preparing the town to identify some priority road segments to move forward with some design and permitting as a part of this grant project. So I'm going to give a project overview. I'll then turn it over to Joe Famely of the Woods Hole Group to provide a presentation on the model used to identify these vulnerable roads. He'll also discuss the risk assessment and the results of that assessment. So the results of that low-lying road screening. We'll then have a discussion either as a whole group or if there are enough of us potentially in breakout groups and then come back together to discuss next steps. So the Cape Cod Commission is conducting this work under two different grants, one from the Economic Development Administration and the other through the Municipal Vulnerability Preparedness Program. The funding under those two programs is slightly different, but effectively goes through June of 2023. We're working with 10 towns across the Cape. And as I've sort of indicated in our purpose here, the overall project is meant to look at the vulnerability of low-lying roads and transportation infrastructure in those 10 towns, help communities identify some priorities, and then actually come up with some potential design solutions for two road segments in each community. There's a public component. This workshop is helping to address that public component and enable the community to understand the assessment and provide feedback. We're having a series of workshops this fall with six of the 10 communities, and then we'll be conducting an additional four workshops with the remaining four communities later this winter or spring. So there are a number of hazards that we face here due to climate change. The focus of this project really is hazards, coastal hazards associated with storm events, sea level rise, and the flooding that results. So here are some images of some of the roads in the Dennis area and effects that you are experiencing already. We know that our storm events are increasing in frequency and intensity, and that together with sea level rise or sea level rise can have various effects on the landscape, including on our roadway network. Sea level rise is a term that we'll sort of talk about throughout this presentation. It may also be described as new flooding extents, new mean high water lines, or nuisance flooding or sunny day flooding. But sea level rise together with storm events are going to increase and exacerbate flooding problems that we're seeing today. So as noted, part of the project here is to identify potential adaptations for two road segments in the town of Dennis. Potential adaptation strategies can really range. Traditionally, roads they're engineered assets in the community, and typically we identify gray infrastructure or traditional engineering solutions for roads. This project means to identify three potential solutions for each of the two road segments that we're looking at. And we're hoping to identify a gray infrastructure solution as well as a green infrastructure solution or more nature-based solution if that is viable for the road segments that we identify. So our timeline here for the project, in short, the Woods Hole group has been working on identifying the shoreline projections utilizing the model that they've developed called the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model, MCFRM. Joe will go into more detail on the development of that model and how it was applied to identify the vulnerable roads. But the first step was to identify shoreline projections under different future sea level rise scenarios and storm event scenarios, use those outputs to identify vulnerable road segments. So conduct that vulnerability assessment. They've been doing this work over the course of the last couple of months. And then utilizing a framework for defining roadway criticality, they then assigned that criticality to the vulnerable roadways to try to identify a priority set of roadway segments to talk about with you all here today. So our workshop today is meant really to present the output of this analysis, present how we conducted this analysis, and to hear from you your reactions to those outputs, your observations from your experience living or working in the community, and add that local knowledge into the consideration of what roadway segments should be identified for the future work under the grant for identifying potential solutions. So the solutions component of this will happen this spring and potentially into the summer. We're seeking an extension on one part of our grant. So we have a bit more time to do this work. And at this point, the end point is a little bit out there, but we expect to identify solutions in the spring summer timeframe. And Sorry about that. So I'm going to pause here and just see if anyone has any questions based on this overview of, you know, the big picture on our project. I'm going to turn it over to Joe in a minute. And I don't see any questions. So, and just to note that we've sort of built in, we're a little bit presentation heavy on this workshop, because we do want you to have a good understanding of how we came to identify these priority road segments. But we're pausing periodically to stop and take questions. We want you to understand what we've done and try to address your questions as we go. So feel free to raise your hand or you know, even put a question in the chat and I'll try to monitor that as we go along. So with that, I will turn it over to Joe and have him present the work the Woods Hole Group has been doing.
Thanks, Heather. So as Heather mentioned, we've been working on modeling the vulnerability and risk to the roadway network across 10 towns, including Dennis. And the hazards that we've been primarily looking at are sea level rise and storm surge. And so there's information available on the state level to look at these hazards, you know, separately in terms of sea level rise and in combination with storm surge. And so the EEA has developed these probabilistic sea level rise projections, which inform our modeling. And those are on this chart. Get it to advance here. So the state selected a high scenario for planning purposes. What that means is there's a very high confidence that conditions won't be worse than these numbers by these timelines. When you consider different emission scenarios, both reduction and continued increases in greenhouse gas emissions, as well as what we know about thermal expansion in the oceans and sort of the state of the science on ice sheet melt and contributions from those sources. I think what these are, what this high scenario tells us is that it's, you know, 99.5% certain not to exceed if you're under a sort of a high emissions scenario, but slightly lower certainty under if you consider ice sheet melt, but still pretty high, you know, like 95%. So take these numbers, and I know Tom was asking about timelines, but we show them in tandem with the intermediate scenario so that, you know, as things play out, because we don't know when these feedback loops will happen in terms of warming, sort of accelerating the ice sheet contribution and making that curve splay out in the future. You can think of these projections as bracketed. So that number in that's flagged at 2030 may end up being your 2050 scenario. Your 2050 might be your 2070. But those in combination with the storm surge modeling can help communities sort of plan, be prepared and plan for the future. And planning in the roadway and infrastructure context in terms of adaptation in a way that's flexible and modular, so you don't build for conditions that are way off in the future and have, you know, a little more uncertainty associated with them. So these are the sea level rise projections that inform the northern part of our model, so the Cape Cod Bay shorelines of Dennis, and similar numbers, slightly different on the south side of the town. As I said, the other hazard that we're looking at is coastal storm surge. And so we have a large data set of both historic and future modeled scenarios for both hurricanes, so tropical storms, and extra tropical or storms or nor'easters. And we run that through our model to develop a probabilistic assessment of flooding now and in the future. So the Massachusetts Coast Flood Risk Model came out of a pilot project for federal highways. It was initially done in the Boston area to assess flooding on the Central Arbery Tunnel System. And it's since been adopted for statewide use, and we have modeled the entire coastal area of Massachusetts. We do a hydrodynamic model because there's a big difference in how a storm acts in real life versus when you visualize a flood scenario, a water surface elevation, in using sort of a bathtub approach. So this map that you see here is a coastal storm, 12 foot NAVD 88 surge. And if you were to visualize that storm surge in most of the online viewers that you see for sea level rise, you brought that bar up to 12, this is what you'd see. But storms don't really act in isolation. There's winds and waves pushing water in different directions. This particular storm that we saw here happens to be a nor'easter. So we have water being pushed up on the south shore from those northeast winds. And so you have a range of water levels, both above and below that 12-foot visualized. And the reason that we adopt a probabilistic approach is in order to help communities plan over time and prioritize their investments in adaptation. So if you think about it in terms of a weather forecast, you might not leave your house with an umbrella and a raincoat if you had like a 10% chance of rain. But if you had like 50% or 100% in the future, you would certainly prepare yourself. So the inputs for our flood risk model include those sea level rise projections that we just looked at and those tropical and extra tropical storm data sets. The model includes roughness coefficients for the landscape. So water flows more freely over paved surfaces than it does in over a field or a marsh or other undeveloped areas. It incorporates the elevation of the land, so we know, you know, how far water can get up on the land surface. And as I said, it incorporates more frequent and more intense storms over time due to climate change. And so the model uses this hydrodynamic approach to incorporate all of those physical processes that inform flooding. So tides, for instance, a hurricane might come through very quickly and only affect really one or two tidal cycles. But a nor'easter may sit on us for a few days and kind of pile water up and build over time. The model also incorporates, as we talked about before, wind and waves, run up and overtopping, And there's a future version that's in the works to incorporate a coastal erosion, so a changed landscape over time, altered elevations. The primary output for the model is flood probability. So what's the chance of flooding during a calendar year at some point on the land? And we'll dig more into those results in a few slides. The other things that we can develop are flood depths. So at any probability level, we can take the water surface elevation and subtract the land elevation to get a depth of flooding. We can also look at how long the water might sit on the land and calculate flood volumes. We can look at flood pathways, which may be small sort of choke points where a targeted intervention might prevent a larger area from extensive flooding. And then we can also back out some of the information on winds and waves and currents, which can help with informed design criteria. It's a very highly resolved model. So this is an example of the model mesh in a portion of Venice. And there's a calculation at each of those points in this triangular network. So every intersection, the model is making a calculation of the probability and the various water surface elevations. So here's the flood inundation probability maps. This is the primary output of the model. You'll see the range of probabilities go from 0.1% in the pink, which is a 1,000-year recurrence interval, to 1% in the light green. Here is another one of note. That's sort of like the 100-year. Think of it as your future FEMA flood zone, all the way up to 100%, which would be the annual storm. So as I step through these slides, you'll see that flooding get more extensive across the landscape, as well as the probabilities will increase at a certain fixed point. So here's present day, 2030, 2050, and 2070. I'm gonna pause there for questions. If anybody has any questions on the inputs or results or how the model works, please let us know and I'd be happy to answer them. I'm having a hard time seeing anything. So if you, I'm just seeing my screen.
Yeah, I don't see any questions or anything in the chat right now.
Okay.
So I think you're good. Keep on.
Okay.
Keep
on. All right, we'll move on. Sounds good. So the way that we're applying these model results to this project is to basically compare the land surface across across the roadway, the elevation of the roadway to those projected water surface elevations. So in this case, we have a cross section of a road that's going down to a beach and down into the water. So you see the probability legend at the bottom here, ranging from that very low probability, high intensity 0.1% chance storm, all the way to the annual storm in blue, dark blue, 100%. And then the cross section of the land going up to the road. And so as we step through time, the extent of that flooding increases. So before we had 0% chance of flooding on the roadway itself. In the sort of near future, we'd be looking at a range of 0.1% chance to 0.5% chance, like a 500-year flood across the roadway. The next time step will increase those probabilities to 1% to 5%. And as you see here, depending on which probability level you're looking at, the depth increases. And then finally, further in the future, looking at sort of like a 10%, to a 10% chance of flooding. So the way that we've done the vulnerability assessment across town is to take all of the road segments, the line files of the road inventory, and break them into points along the roadway in a very fine scale, and do this sort of comparison between the projected water surface elevation and the road elevation at that spot. That gives us the vulnerability assessment, so the probability of flooding. The next part of the assessment is looking at how important that road is across a variety of criteria. In this case, we looked at how the road is connected to community or emergency services, how important or what's the functionality of the road? Is it a local sort of neighborhood road? Is it a connector? Is it a state road or a highway? So there's a variety of functional classifications that that MassDOT provides that sort of look at connectivity of the roadway system. And then also considering average daily use. We also looked at whether or not the roadway was in an area of high business activity. So in other planning efforts, Cape Cod Commission has developed some GIS files that look at the number and density of businesses in different areas. And finally, we looked at whether or not the road was within an area that served a vulnerable population. So whether it was in an environmental justice population or from the CDC's social vulnerability index for access to housing and transportation. So all of these scores rolled up into one criticality score, and we use both the criticality and the vulnerability to inform calculation of risk. So inundation probability or vulnerability times criticality score gives us risk. If we have something that is a very high probability of flooding, but is not that consequential to the town in terms of services and access, then it might not be that important to address right away. However, if the roadway is both vulnerable and important, then that would be a high priority to consider for adaptation. So that's the general approach that we used. And the next set of slides, maybe it'd be good to pause right there. If anybody has any questions on the approach before we start looking at results.
I'm not seeing any, I'm seeing a thumbs up. So
okay.
Carry on.
There. Okay. So looking at the results, we have both, as I said, the sea level rise projections, as well as the sea level rise and storm surge modeling. And first, we looked at the road surface elevations compared to the projected mean high water elevation over time. So these are sea level rise projections adjusted for local tidal conditions in 2030, 2050, and 2070. And as I said, these are sort of high confidence that it won't be worse than this. So of the 278 miles of roadway in the town, very small portion of those are vulnerable to nuisance flooding in the near term. So this would be like the average of the day's high tides, mean high water. So less than a mile vulnerable to nuisance flooding in the near term. This doesn't really account for, you know, winds and obviously it doesn't account for storms. Mid-century, that nuisance flooding increases to over 5.5 miles, 5.7. And later in the century, might be looking at over 14 miles of roadway affected by nuisance flooding. So those correspond to the dark to light blue on this map. And what we see is a lot more of that is concentrated on the south side of the town. And then a little bit across and adjacent to some of the waterways inland. Probability. So this is the projected water surface elevation from the model compared to the road surface elevation. Under 2030 conditions, and let's just look at the 1% chance of that. So the 100-year storm of the near future could affect almost 37 miles of roadway throughout town. And if you look at these color bands and how they correspond to dots, then you'll get a sense of where the higher probabilities are, definitely along the southern facing shorelines and you know, bridge crossings or other low-lying areas adjacent to the water. And then, you know, as the land comes up, those probabilities get lower. Under 2050 conditions, that extent of flooding expands and the probabilities increase. The 1% chance event, the 100-year flood under a mid-century condition, would affect a little over 70 miles of roadway in Dennis. And finally, later in the century, again, that extent of flooding expands and the probabilities increase, affecting almost 83 miles of roadway in town. So those are that's for the vulnerability assessment. That's the probability of flooding. The next component, as we reviewed before, is criticality. So across those four categories of evaluation, those kind of roll up into a 0 to 100 scale. And we then develop these criticality scores for the entire town. What you see is sort of a concentration of higher scores associated with the more used and populated and I guess also the business corridors that's kind of generating these hotter areas, especially on the south side, but also some you know, critical roadways on the north side as well. When we intersect those two sets of information, so probability and criticality, we get risk. And so on a scale of low to high, basically from green to yellow to red, we're seeing obviously increasing risk over time. And these first set of roads are associated with a 2030, these are sort of the highest scoring, highest risk roads under the near-term conditions. So Route 28 over Weir Creek, Indian Trail, which is a residential area system of roads right by the water, Lower County Road at Weir Creek, Lighthouse Road, Uncle Stevens Road, Trotting Park Road, and a portion of 6A by Quivet Creek. I think I should go back a step. If there's an asterisk next to the road, that indicates that it's a state-owned road. So this project is evaluating all roads, both public and private. And we are also including state-owned roads, even though the town may not have ultimate control over those roadways. We're doing the risk assessment anyway, so that it can inform planning and hopefully future conversations with MassDOT. Under 2050, sort of mid-century conditions, we're adding Old Wharf Road, Upper County Road, Lower County Road at Swan Pond River, two sections of 28, one at Swan Pond River, the other at west of Center Street, some roads on the east side of Sisuit Harbor, Cold Storage Road and Saltworks, Bridge Street on the other side of Sisuit Harbor, and New Boston Road. And finally, later on in the century, some increased vulnerability to Dr. Vaquero Road, Chad Hole, Lower County Road, and the portion of Route 28 at Bass River. So this is basically summarizing all of those results. We have, and we'll show you in the viewer in a minute. We have the road name, a little more detailed description of what and where that road is, the length affected by flooding under the later in the century, 2070 time horizon, the ranges of probabilities that affect that length. So that's the storm inundation probability. And then finally at the end here is an assessment of the length that could be affected by that nuisance flooding. So obviously if it's a lower lying road, it's gonna be higher probability of inundation from storm surge. And if it's especially low, it could also be exposed to daily flooding in the near to later future. So the red box at the top indicates the top five high risk roads for Dennis under that 2030 scenario. Going down to the dotted line includes additional roads under the 2050 and 2070 time horizons. So maybe I'll stop there. If anybody has some questions, feel free to ask while I switch over to the data viewer.
Also not seeing any questions right now, so.
I'll just quickly walk through the process that we just described on one road. This happens to be the one at the top of the list, Route 28 at Weir Creek. So this segment here is the vulnerable segment. I'll just show that layer here. And the data that informs that includes both this nuisance flooding. So these portions of the roadway are vulnerable to nuisance flooding later in the century, 2070. We look at inundation probability, as we said, so 2030, 2050, 2070. And just to give you an idea, you can click on any of these nodes. Sorry. Sorry, I'm having trouble with this. You can click on the nodes and there's a pop-up window that that provides the probability and the elevation. We have the criticality scores mapped as well. So those are on a range from basically 0 to 100. The scores in Dennis range from 5 to 70. And then finally, the risk scores in 2030, 2050. And 2070. So as we said before, probability times consequence gets risk. Because this was a high risk road under all three time horizons, it was prioritized in that list. So maybe what we'll do next is step through all of those roadways that we talked about before so you get a sense of where they are. So the first one is right here, 28 at Weir Creek and Old Main Road. Oops, sorry. Next is Indian Trail, this residential area off of Upper County Road. Next is Lower County Road, a low-lying portion near Uncle Stephen's Pond in Weir Creek. I'm just going to zoom out a little bit here so you get a little context. So Uncle Stephen's Pond here, Weir Creek up here. A little further down the road, Lighthouse Road at Uncle Stephen's Pond. Shifting over to Uncle Stephen's Road. So this area is obviously very low-lying, lots of vulnerable roads and a dense area. I think one thing to note is on Uncle Stephen's Road, we found that some portions of it were listed in the MassDOT Road Inventory as private. Some are town-owned and some are private.
Joe, if you could just pause for a second. There was a question from Spencer Stone about the color legend on this map.
Sure. So that corresponds to the probability. So zero is gray, same as the other maps that we were looking at. Pink is 0.1, and then going up through the rainbow, 0.2, 0.5. One is the light green, 2%, 5%, 10 to 20 in purple, and 100% in dark blue. Sure. So I think we were at Trotting Park. I'm just going to turn on. Make sure that we know. Which road we're looking at. Okay, so Trotting Park is this road running north-south on the east side of Uncle Stephen's Pond. Let's go back to probability again. Sorry. So high probability in the curve, which is right next to the pond, and then sort of 10 to 20% in the near term. Next one is portion of 6A near Quivet Creek, right on the town line. So looks like the road is low at the intersection and goes down as it goes towards Brewster here. Old Wharf Road, right along the shoreline, and looks like a public beach. Very high probability of flooding. Upper County Road, which includes the bridge over Swan Pond. So under this segment, there's a lower section here. The bridge is up a little bit. So these are like 10% and then 5% over on this side. Lower County Road over Swan Pond River. Again, it's sort of lower on one side and then gets a little higher on the other. So higher probability on the west side, slightly lower probability on the east side. Route 28 at Swan Pond River also includes a bridge. Looks like in the range of, I think that's 5 to 10%. Sorry, 2 to 5%. Route 28 west of Center Street. Zoom out a little bit here. So looks like a dip in the road that goes from pretty high under 2030 conditions. There's, you know, no chance of flooding at either end, and then dips down. Perhaps there's a culvert right there. Going over back over to the north side, Cold Storage Road and Saltworks Road on the east side of Suet, low portion right by the boat ramp entrance, as well as along the creek and wetland. Shifting to the west a little bit, the bridge over Suet Creek and the roadway and Bridge Street itself. Very high probability of flooding in the middle, and then both sides go up a little bit. New Boston Road, which sort of connects a isolated neighborhood adjacent to Chase Garden Creek. So right there, there's a low point across that creek. And then further off under, you know, later century conditions, these are 2030 probabilities. But if we turn on 2050 or 2070, Dr. Botero Road, inundation probability increases. There's 2050. 2070, so 20 to 100%. Just zoom out for a little context here. So that's the connection point to Chapin Memorial Beach. Last two, Lower County Road so Chad Hole and Lower County Road intersection looks like there's a lower spot on the west side, a little bit higher at the intersection. But as time goes on, those probabilities increase. And the last one is Route 28 at the Bass River. Sorry. Low spot right by the Bass River Park. So sort of a 10 to 20% chance goes back up at the bridge and on the east side. And as time goes on, those probabilities increase. So that's sort of the tour of our results and kind of a primer on the online viewer. So I guess at this point, I'll turn it back over to Heather. And if anybody has any questions on process or results, feel free to chime in. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Joe. That was a terrific overview of a lot of material. Here we're going to transition into more of a discussion portion of our workshop here. And actually, maybe I'll just move on to my screen sharing. There we go. So we have, I'm counting about, 12 to 13 folks from the town of Dennis. There are a lot of Cape Cod Commission staff on hand in case we were going to go into breakout sessions. A couple of other folks. But I think we'll just stay in one large group for this discussion. I think we'd all benefit from hearing from one another, and hopefully we can give everyone an opportunity to speak who wishes to. So I'm going to set up that discussion in just a minute or two, but I think at this point, I'd like to ask Tom Andre to make any comments that he might like to about work that the town of Dennis has done, is in process on, is thinking about with regard to low-lying roads and resiliency.
Yeah, thank you, Heather. So great analysis. And I think you'll get some good feedback from the town of Dennis, because most of these locations that are showing up on this view are issues that we have flooding problems with. So as far as projects that we are working on that kind of go along with this analysis. So I'll start on the north side with Dr. Patero. We are looking at that with some grants as well for resiliency project. So we have a big revetment up there that we are also facing erosion problems along with the flooding issues there. So we're looking at possibly doing some work up there through some grants. Staying up on the north side and coming down along Route 6A, a couple of those locations that flooded up off of Sisuit Creek, MassDOT just recently put in a project to replace a couple of the culverts that cross underneath there. So we're hoping that that's going to at least maybe not get rid of the flooding over the road, but at least help it drain a little bit faster when it does go through and lessen the impacts coming through there. Bridge Street, that was we always have a problem there. That was a major culvert replacement and salt marsh restoration quite a while back now. It's that has worked fairly well, but we unfortunately still get flooding there. So, maybe some of this analysis would have been good in that design when we were going through that replacement. Continuing on, some of the smaller local projects, we're working on a couple of grants to do some work at our landings to help improve the resiliency there, so that we're looking at the flooding impacts on all of those landings as well through a Cape Cod Conservation District grant, as well as working with the APCC. The town itself is looking at putting together a culvert priority list. So a lot of these locations that cross 6A, across lower county for the most part, we're looking at doing some work and replacing some of those culverts. So we're going to be putting together a priority list. As far as Route 28 goes, we just reconstructed Route 28 in Dennisport. So I know one of the locations there that I wasn't too familiar with flooding there was just constructed, but the next section in West Dennis that we're looking at, we're definitely going to include this flooding analysis in on that, because starting at the Bass River Bridge and coming down by Bass River Park, it was an area that showed as a flooding issue on your sea level viewer here, which was very helpful. That is going towards design. We're at 25% design now, so we're going to make sure that that gets included on that. We're looking at the Lower County Bridge. That was one of the locations on here. We have a consultant on board that is going to put together a possible bridge replacement plan for that, so we can plan for the future. And we'll make sure that the design for the is including the flooding impacts as well. So other than that, I think the analysis that you put together here was excellent. I know I took a drive yesterday afternoon during the high tide. It's not the highest tide of the month, but it's a pretty high tide. And a lot of the areas that you identified here, Lighthouse Road, the water was right up next to the road on a regular high tide. So all the analysis that that Joe just went through was pretty spot on, I think. So I'm looking forward to hearing from the other town employees. I know we have a bunch of DPW employees in a conference room, so you're not seeing how many there are there, but I know there's a few in there as well that have some historic input as well. So when we start talking about that part of it, I'm sure other people will have some good discussions. And just so you know, that the pictures that you showed in the beginning, a couple of those were the locations that you were looking at on Route 6A and cold storage, and that car that's half underwater. So thank you to the fire chief for providing those pictures there. So you can see what we're going through. The challenge for us, we have a lot of fairly main roads here. The lower counties are going to be a big one. The old wharfs are all big ones. We do rely on MassDOT with Route 28 and Route 6A for main evacuation routes as well too, and unfortunately both of those roads are low-lying roads, so we're gonna have to work with them, and that's going to be a challenge for us moving forward. So that's it for me. Thank you for going through this. It's excellent analysis.
Great. Well, thank you, Tom. That was really, I think, helpful for us and hopefully for the other folks on the call to understand what's going on in town, the work that the town has been working on. It sounds like there's actually quite a bit, which is great.
One last one, Heather, I forgot Weir Creek at Lower County. We haven't started the process there, but we are possibly looking at doing a salt marsh restoration and replacing that culvert with probably a bridge of some kind there too. So. That's that. So that's with some of the infrastructure funding coming in place, we're trying to stay ahead of some of these by at least getting some conceptual designs in place. So if the money does become available, hopefully we'll be in good shape to take advantage of it.
Great. All right. Well, so now we're going to try to transition to a broader discussion. And I hadn't focused on the fact that there's a room full of engineering folks. I hope that everyone has an opportunity to speak who'd like to. I think we can probably manage that. But let me just set this up a little bit. So we've provided a lot of information here for folks to digest. And hopefully Joe's sort of careful presentation of the different elements help your understanding of the work that we've done, and you can take that in and start to digest it. But part of what we'd like to do here is talk about, with the ultimate goal of, let me just sort of set this out there too. The ultimate goal here is the second part of our grant is to provide further analysis for two road segments in the town of Dennis. Woods Hole Group, together with a subcontractor, will be looking at the two road segments that the town identifies and identifying three potential solutions for those road segments, developing some conceptual designs, sort of ranging from a traditional gray infrastructure approach to a green infrastructure approach, if appropriate, and identifying some cost estimates for those different approaches as well. So that's where we're headed. But what we'd like to do in this conversation is to make really sort of expand the conversation beyond the analysis that we've done based on the model and the data and the framework that we identified for establishing, you know, defining what is a critical road segment. But are there road segments that we've missed is perhaps the first part of our conversation here. Are there things that you're aware of that should be added? So we'd like to get those out for discussion and consideration. And then what sort of local knowledge can you bring to this conversation overall, you know, with an eye toward how to prioritize the road segments that Joe presented? What do you know about how the community utilizes the road network? What are the you know, key roads that the community relies on? Are there vulnerable populations that you're aware of in a certain area? Are there some areas that have a much higher year-round population and or conversely a very high seasonal population? And that might figure into how you might prioritize a road segment. Or, you know, as Tom indicated, the state roads are ones that we all rely on greatly for emergency access, and they're really quite vulnerable in Dennis. So, you know, do you concur with that, or there are other thoughts along those lines? And I think, you know, our thought is if we can collectively sort of pool our thoughts on this, that will help town staff as they help identify the two road segments that will carry forward for the remaining part of this project. So I'd like to open the conversation up here and just invite people to, you know, raise your hand. You could put questions or comments in the chat if you'd like, or, you know, unmute yourself. That's fine too. I think we can probably manage that with this group. And also note that the viewer that Joe just most recently went through will be available for your use. You can review the data layers in more detail at your leisure. And you know, we're not looking for the town to identify these road segments immediately. The community can take a little time to think about how to utilize these grant funds and, you know, use that viewer to have some additional time to think and reflect on this work. So with that, I'll stop talking and see if anyone wants to chime in with your own observations or thoughts, sort of maybe starting with, are there any roads that we've missed? And I'm not seeing anyone raising their hand, or Tom, please.
Yeah, so I did spend a lot of time looking at the viewer, and it's a great tool. So I certainly would encourage everybody to take a look at that as well, because you can turn on a 1 foot sea level rise or 2 foot sea level rise, and you can see how the flooding impacts move in. So that is good. I think the just looking at the immediate first roads that are going to be impacted by the lower level sea level rise, I think the list is actually pretty good. And obviously, once you get into the 3, 4, 5 foot, you're getting more and more into the locations there. So yeah, the thing that's interesting to me is you know, a lot of these roads that are like Lighthouse Road and Loring Ave, you know, that those are obviously the most vulnerable ones because they're so low, but the entire area is low. And that's the kind of the challenge that we have with some of those. You know, the Indian Trail, same thing. It's the whole entire area is low. So when we're putting together the priority list, you know, certainly these roads would be certainly make a sense to make a priority. It's just a matter of, it'd be interesting to see what Woods Hole Group is going to propose to fix big areas like that, if there is a fix, or does it make sense to look at main routes that have a relatively smaller area and see if we can attack those. And that's going to be, I think, the discussion point going forward, but the list certainly looks good.
Great. Well, and I just was brought to my attention that Spencer Stone added a couple of thoughts in the chat. Spencer, if you want to unmute yourself and comment. Or if not, I can just...
Heather, before we go to that comment, let me just give you some thoughts on Tom's question.
Sure.
So, you know, it's really up to you to decide what you want to tackle. Depending on the location, there could be some solutions if there's enough space to address more extensive flooding with sort of like a landscape berm, or if it's a shore parallel roadway, perhaps you know, an elevated dune and beach nourishment could provide some protection to certain storms. One thing to consider is private property, and that's probably going to be an issue in that Indian Trail area, as well as if you're elevating a road, the tie-ins to driveways and other spots could make that difficult and might drive you towards some of the more near-term focused areas of flooding where, you know, there might be a critical connection point that dips down and comes back up, and raising a certain area or elevating a bridge or culvert could be a solution. Another thing I'd consider is exposure to nuisance flooding over time, the design life of the roadway itself or the bridge, and how that lines up with exposure both to nuisance flooding, which, you know, gives you really just kind of daily access concerns, and then how that also lines up with the different ranges of probability over time. You could potentially not need to design yourself out of every single storm. It might not make sense to go to a, you know, 0.1% elevation to make sure that roadway is dry in every possible storm. Might not even make sense to design to a 1% storm. You know, it's a sort of a question of risk tolerance. What makes sense in terms of, you know, probability and what else might be going on in terms of planning and sort of positioning of services and access to services both during and immediately after a storm event. Those are all things to consider as you're making these choices. I hope that helps and doesn't make things more unwieldy.
Great. So before I go to Dan, Spencer noted that his mic isn't working, but he's provided some pictures in the chat. I'm actually having a little trouble downloading them. But his point is that Lighthouse Road at Weir Creek Bridge and Uncle Stephen's Pond is a problem area, and that Lighthouse Road is presently inundated at every winter tide, high tide, and was not explicitly identified.
Heather, do you mind if I switch back over?
Yes, please.
Okay. So Lighthouse, you might have to talk me through that question again.
So down on the south side, you know, right on the sound. If you go to
So just turn back the it's on. So the question was about Lighthouse Road.
Lighthouse Inn Road.
Can you hear me now?
So.
No.
So Lighthouse Road is here.
Lighthouse Inn Road is, I think, just to the east.
Just right. To the east.
It's just north of where your arrow is now. No, come back down. It's that road right. If now go left.
This one, yeah.
So that's Lighthouse Road. And like I said yesterday, I was out there in yesterday's high tide, and it was slightly underwater just with yesterday's high tide from Uncle Stephen's flooding over. Lighthouse Road itself was probably about 1 or 2 feet above the water, but it actually did come across Lighthouse Inn Road, just about where your arrow is.
Yep. This one here. Okay. Yep. So first, it looks like some portions of that are lower and therefore more exposed to nuisance flooding in the nearer term. I think what I heard somebody yesterday, that there was a little wind associated with that high tide yesterday. So that could be affecting, you know, where the water is. Did you say it came from Uncle Stephen's pond or from the sound?
From Uncle Stephen's pond.
Okay.
Yeah, if you have a wetland layer there, you'll see it. It abuts Lighthouse Inn Road as well.
Yep.
Yeah. So see where that's the marshy area is next to Lighthouse Road.
Yep.
A little bit south of that, right. Yes, oh, yeah, come down Lighthouse Road where the dark blue is, right there. Yep.
Yeah.
That's where it was flooding yesterday afternoon, just in regular high tide. So,
okay.
And I think Mr. Stone, that's on the phone, has shown me pictures from previous high tides already this year that it always gets inundated there. So that's one of the first spots that does flood in the town of Dennis.
Okay, so we could just kind of walk through that. It was definitely identified as something that's potentially exposed to nuisance flooding. The probability was certainly high, even in the near term, for both of those road segments. So Lighthouse Point, and this is the one that you said is Lighthouse Point Inn, Lighthouse Inn, right there?
Yep.
Yeah, Lighthouse Inn Road, okay. So all of those are basically at the same high probability. And that's why that road was delineated in one of the higher risk areas. That probability extends and increases over time. The criticality may have been a differentiating factor. So this is 25. Sorry for the header there, and that should be Dennis. This portion is getting higher criticality scores. Could be because of the type of roadway it is or traffic count. Yeah, traffic count is, so this is a Lighthouse Road is a more used road than Lighthouse Inn Road. Community and emergency services don't seem to be associated with these segments. They are both environmental justice and social vulnerability mapped areas. I think the difference is the type of roadway. So this is a local road and has a lower traffic count. Is a collector and has a higher traffic count. So this is a good example. So it's both have, you've got two roadways with basically equal probability of flooding. The way that we have assessed criticality gives more weight to Lighthouse Road than Lighthouse Inn Road. And therefore the risk scores are higher along Lighthouse Road, slightly, but higher. You know, so these are 24. So I mean, they are similar, and you could certainly, you know, include or say that this is also a critical portion that's vulnerable and should be associated with Lighthouse Road. We just happened to identify that segment. So again, this is exactly why we're talking to you. So mm-hmm. Slight differences in the criticality, which I think informed the delineation of Lighthouse Road and didn't include the Lighthouse Inn Road. Does that help?
Yeah, I think that's helpful. We have two hands up. I want to start with Dan Fortier and then Fire Chief Robert Brown. So Dan, go ahead.
Okay, Joe, just curious, maybe I missed this. To sure. What extent beyond sea level rise has this brought in subsidence of the land? If you go just east of Uncle Stephen's Pond, that area around Fiddler's Green, Lanyard Lane, which is all black on your risk map, is from homes that have done work in that area in my 20 years here, they have shown that their 1990s elevation certificates, when they came in to do work pre-flood map change, they were showing as much as a 6-inch drop in their land area on their site in that neighborhood. Has that any of that been built into this modeling? Because especially that area between Trotting Park Road and Swan River was all built on fill. It was all marsh at one point in time and built on fill. And similarly in the area around the Plashes over in Dennisport where the cottage colonies are, a lot of that was built on fill as well of marshland.
Okay, that's good to know, Dan. So the model mesh, that framework that you saw with all the triangles and dots in it, at every point in that model framework, we are getting an elevation, and that elevation is coming from the most recently available LIDAR at the time of the modeling. So I think what we used was a 2017 topobathy layer that was available. It's sort of a composite of the most recently available LIDAR data sets for the Commonwealth. So the elevations in the model are up to date as recent as 2017.
But there's no way of modeling or finding data that might show any historical of how that area might be settling in those parts of town.
No, sort of like the landscape at the time of that that LIDAR.
Okay, no, I was just curious because it just makes things a little more challenging as some areas of town are along with sea level rising, the ground level is going down in those neighborhoods as well. And that's going to completely change the formula more.
Yeah, so the what the model outputs, in addition to probability, is it gives us that water surface elevation, and that's in AVD 88. So you can go back and survey any of those places to see how the elevation certificate may have changed if you got a subsiding building and then the point of entry to water is lower now than it was 10 years ago, that can certainly be compared to the projected water surface elevations.
Yeah, I think a lot of those roads might be private roads in those neighborhoods. So probably increases the challenge of what we do. Tom, Lanyard Lane, is that town owned?
No, that's private.
That's what I thought. Yeah, so a lot of that area that's still, especially on that side of the Swan River, the roads are private roads, and they're going to be a private issue when, you know, they go down. So that along with 3 feet increase in sea level, you might see a 6-inch decrease in the elevation of the road.
Yeah, that's a lot.
Yeah.
And interestingly enough, if you look at this that viewer there, if you get to a 3 or 4 foot rise, that's when you get Swan Pond River and Bass River are basically connecting across that whole area south of Lower County. So all of those areas down to South Village, the Baker's Way, it's all underwater. So there's a series of culverts that drain that. So, you know, I think our best bet may be to replace the culverts with larger culverts just to get the water out faster. I don't think we're ever going to stop the flooding. I think it's just a matter of how quickly we get rid of it.
Well, I think as you look at the Weir Creek all the way up through 28, I mean, you know, the 1% storm, the Weir Creek is going to connect over across 28 and up to the Bass River as well. So we've got, you know, that whole area of West Dennis is going to be, yeah, right through there. That whole area of West Dennis is an island in a 1% storm.
Yeah.
So you got high probability of flooding down here as well.
There. Yeah.
Pretty exactly. High, not quite as high, but right across there. So those are three major, I don't know, is major the right word there, Dan? I mean, these seem like pretty well-used roads.
I think it's critical because you do wind up with essentially that portion of West Dennis becomes only serviceable from Yarmouth if there's a fire, unless we were to basically locate emergency crew in that portion of West Dennis if a big storm is forecast. And I think that's part of, you know, going beyond the low-lying roads. That's a whole aspect of our hazard mitigation issue is we have that part of West Dennis and parts of Dennisport that become almost inaccessible in a 1% storm.
Yeah, so I'm just checking the community services layer. So I didn't mention this before, but all of the data layers that went into the criticality score are also available in this online map. So you have a fire department station. You have a fire station here. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So if we turn on that, and then, let's look at probability. I see. So there. Yeah.
And
they're cut off from that area. Potentially
it may be in a storm east. That they have to station an ambulance at the West Dennis Graded Schoolhouse or something.
Yep.
In order to be able to serve that area. But even then, you know, they can't get to the hospital.
So let's actually go to Fire Chief Robert Brown and see what's on his mind.
Thank you and good morning. No, I just, Dan actually just picked up on most of my points. And I'm glad we're all on the same page when it comes to that, you know, getting down. So routinely on the emergency management side, we put when we know that we have storms coming of any kind of magnitude at all. And lately they seem to be, you know, closer and closer together. We actually we drop off road closure devices for Lighthouse Road and pretty much write that whole area off. And the interesting thing is that they're building, just going back to what Dan was saying, they're building that much more in those, you know, down in that area. And of course, closer to the water, and they're building higher and bigger and better. So all along that whole southern beach area is, you know, drastically growing, which, you know, it's what if everybody wants to see the ocean until it's at their front door, you know? No, it's just, and just going back to, you know, we've recognized this. We're in the process right now of building, hopefully after today, building a new station too. And with the idea that if something were to happen to this station, we can at least operate out of the other one. We're building it big enough to accommodate, but it's on the other end of town. But no, we've been noticing these maps and how we're technically going to be an island at our firehouse. And we won't be able to get into Dennisport either, you know, Dan. So we'd have to be thinking about putting something down there as well, you know, on the other side of Swan River. So
yeah, you both bring up good points about access both during a storm and when you're thinking about, you know, building happening in some of these areas that, you know, with elevating a building, you can potentially build yourself out of flood exposure, but that doesn't really say anything for the road network that gets to you or the services that you may require, both in an emergency and on a daily basis.
But our collaboration right now with our DPW and police and everybody, we pre-position already road closure barricades based on even some of those pictures that that you posted early on. And these are just, it's just more and more routine for us. So we kind of have this all worked into our plan throughout the town. It's going to be pretty scary if and when this all takes place here, but we're definitely starting to see some of it now.
Yeah, Chief, we definitely have recognized that basically West Dennis and Dennisport become islands. I like to point out to everybody, and if you guys haven't seen the photos, the Historical Commission has a number of photos taken by Betty Mullen from the 44 hurricane. And it, you know, shows the Lower County Road, the Route 28. I don't know if she made it all the way up to Upper County Road, but in 44, all three of those bridges washed out.
Yeah.
And Dennisport was cut off from the rest of the town. And so, you know, it is, you know, as we think, you know, beyond just Tom's road maintenance issues and needs, I think we got to be sure we're also using this data to know what our emergency services staffing needs are going to be. Because, I mean, Chief, you got a tough job there if we get a storm like 44.
Yeah.
You need twice the men you have, I think, just to have people in the islands.
Yep.
All right. Helpful. Tom, you just put your hand up again.
Yeah, so I just want to let you know there are five DPW and engineering people in the conference room that are on that that line. So I did go in there and check in, and Rob Kroll is one of our longtime DPW employees, and he brought up a very good point about the criteria up on New Boston Road, up in the very north west corner that comes off of Chase Garden Creek. That creek floods, but the first place it floods is New Boston, and it cuts off that whole neighborhood to the west. And there's only one way in, one way out, and it's not too much different than Lighthouse Road. You know, where Lighthouse Road is more private property, this is also a lot of town-owned roads that are completely cut off. And even a regular storm that we can get, it can be 2 or 3 feet underwater at that where Chase Garden Creek crosses. So, as far as prioritizing roads, obviously any place that is completely cut off should have a little bit of a weight as well.
Yeah, great point. So yeah, maybe if there aren't other obvious roads that we've missed here, we can transition more to that conversation about, yeah, local knowledge about just this kind of thing. Are there neighborhoods that look like they would be cut off? Other emergency access type priorities? You know, we used data that we've collected with regard to emergency services, emergency buildings and town assets to build into our criticality layer. But, you know, that data is only as good as, you know, we have from you. So there may be things that we haven't captured that we want to make sure we're recognizing either through this conversation or even, you know, updating the resource list that we have. So yeah, just to encourage people to sort of think about some of the priorities for how the community uses its road network.
Yeah, and the criticality doesn't capture the exact, you know, concern that was just raised, which is an isolated neighborhood, because the things that we're looking at were, you know, the use of the roadway, the type of, whether it's a local road, which probably a lot of these neighborhoods are local roads, not a lot of business, and the emergency services aren't there, but they would obviously need to get there. So this is where, like, the risk framework can provide a first cut, and we're certainly looking to all of you to provide that second layer of input.
Tom, I see your hand is up. Did you want to say something, or is just still up?
Well, it was still up, but I would say, yeah, certainly there's some DPW people here, and obviously the fire chief. I'd like them to weigh in as to you know, we obviously give up, like Chief Brown said, on Lighthouse Road. It's not maybe the right thing to do, but there's not much we can do. So that road, those roads get cut off. So that's the thing. But, you know, just as far as the nuisance ones that happen all the time, quickly in my mind, going forward, and I'll have the DPW again chime in, because they're the ones that have to go out there and put the barrels out all the time. But New Boston Road floods all the time. Route 6A floods all the time on multiple locations where Sisuit Creek and Quabbit Creek cross. That's on the north side, Bridge Street as well. Then on the south side, you know, I think we're looking at Loring, Lighthouse, and Lower County. Those would be the priority roads that I think flood all the time. But I would like to hear from the DPW or the fire chief on any other roads that they would like to add.
Obviously, I mean, for us, it's, you know, the biggest populations are a big, you know, a big concern for us. And state roads naturally are our biggest avenue to get anywhere in town. So, you know, when you're talking about Route 28 and Route 6A being underwater, you know, in certain areas, you're immediately cutting off, you know, large pieces of residential areas that we can't get to. So that's obviously, you know, the state roads are where we, in my opinion, where we got to start. You know, it's all from our history. You know, we don't, just like Dan was saying, you know, in these different storms, we're talking, those pictures that I took were only, those storms weren't really of any kind of, you know, super magnitude that were like hurricanes or anything like that. Those were just winter storms. And it put 6A, underwater in, you know, two major areas. Not to mention, if you look out towards, you know, Knob's Gusset and Hope Lane and Beach Street over there in the north side, there's a huge year-round population that lives out in that area that are going to be isolated. They're going to be cut off, you know, through, because of that Garden Creek over there. Chase's Garden Creek. These are our concerns. You know, Quivet Creek, we know, you know, getting back over to East Dennis, we know that that's going to isolate a whole bunch of year-round people.
Sorry, some of these crossings here?
Yes, yeah, all those crossings, yeah.
One, two, three, four connection points.
And we have a picture. Higher. We have a picture on New Boston Road where a 3-foot barrel a 3 foot or a 4 foot high where that creek, right where New Boston, I think it's Hall Street, where it's all black. If you come down to Boston, there was a 3 foot barrel, 4 foot barrel, a highway barrel underwater. It gets pretty high in that, you know, and then it, the water's trapped up in there. It doesn't drain. Like Tom was talking about, once it gets up in there, it doesn't drain
for a while.
You know?
Yeah. So it's interesting. This neighborhood is sort of, as you guys said, it's a one way in, one way out.
Right.
The other access points to this dense neighborhood here, couple, 1, 2, 3 crossings of Chase Garden Creek, which, you know, they're still on the higher end of the probability. That 5% chance is a little bit lower, but these are like 10 to 20. But have you been able to access through Elm Street?
Well, that's our plan right now. And so looking forward as far as, you know, emergency, I'm heavily, you know, naturally we're heavily involved with emergency management in town. So, we have to look at these avenues to get in there.
So then over the longer term, those also might be restricted.
Yeah. So and I know we're
longer term, something to look at.
Excuse me, Joe. I know we're looking at roads. One of the things I brought up earlier in the process was, we're looking at doing a culvert priority list. And sometimes, you know, maybe looking at a watershed like this, where, you know, maybe replacing a series of culverts on multiple roads would be, give us a real good bang for our buck. So me as the engineer, I'm looking for what is going to fix a problem quickly? What could we possibly get funding for replacement, so grant money for, so if that's an option as well, looking at Chase Garden Creek and any crossing there that's cutting something off, I know that the further east you go, the higher flooding is required to put those out of service, but that's certainly something that we're looking at anyway, as far as our program, so I'm not sure if we can consider that.
Go ahead. I think that just sort of putting thoughts together with regard to a couple of things that have been said. Back to Fire Chief Brown's comments about the state roads being, they're providing some critical access infrastructure for really large populations, and not just within the town of Dennis. I mean, they are state routes. This project, these state roads have come up multiple times in various towns, and there are some vulnerabilities that MassDOT needs to address. And I think that one of the outcomes of this project should be a list of priority roads across the 10 towns that we're working with that MassDOT should elevate on their list of priorities. So that said, if a community wanted to look at a particular segment of a state route at a conceptual level, and then provide that, the potential design solutions that would come out of that analysis to MassDOT to sort of push the point, that could be an approach. I think perhaps a more practical approach, recognizing that we'll be communicating this information to MassDOT separately, in any case, a more practical approach at the town level is to look at road segments that are priorities that you can actually address. And if that includes segments that are culverts, I think there's nothing, I think that's absolutely a viable approach, especially when you're thinking about you know, just improving functionality in the community. If the culvert, replacing a culvert will improve drainage or could be designed to improve drainage, that seems like a huge benefit. Some of the things that I've heard mentioned here, reflect thinking about year-round populations and areas, roads that service large populations. So, you know, those seem to be priorities just within this conversation that might help focus, you know, some attention on this long list that we have for the town of Dennis. Try to winnow down which ones you want to focus on.
This area that we've been talking about here along Chase Garden Creek is kind of interesting because there's redundancy and there's also opportunity because it goes from a high point to another high point. So I'm looking at, you know, 2030, 2050, and 2070. There's still, you know, very little flooding on the state road. It would take a huge storm to get up here, even in very far off future. So let's look in the near to midterm. You know, doing something here to reduce that probability. Maybe this becomes a low, maybe you can bring it down to a 1% chance, basically get this elevation across the way and get a culvert improvement to increase drainage. And then choose one of these to also take a similar approach so that you have some way to access both of these areas. Be something to consider because there's very limited potential for nuisance flooding. And the potential, I think, to address some of the storm, especially if you don't, if you kind of accept some level of risk, I think there's some possibilities there.
So we could potentially, you know, just go back to the list. And if I share my screen, I want to, you know, continue to move around the viewer if that's of interest, but also just take a look at the overall list of road segments so folks have those all in mind. And, you know, if there are comments that anyone would like to offer now about any priorities that seem obvious that you'd like to, you know, either say roads A, G, and T are, you know, really important, or conversely, there are ones that seem less important that we should drop off. That'd be great to share with the group now. We're nearing our noontime end for the workshop, so I do want to be respectful of everyone's time. But if there were any thoughts along those lines, love to get those out here. And then I have one slide to just sort of provide some next steps, let people know where we're going from here.
Well, I can take a stab at the ones that are probably the most immediate ones going through, and please everyone weigh in here. But I would say C, D. Then I would go to G. M, N, O. So those are the ones that I would say, even on regular storms, we get flooding. Now, then going back towards the Route 28s in the lower county, would be, you know, we can start talking about those. But those are the ones that I think are immediately stand out to me.
Great.
Yeah, I agree with Tom on that as well.
Great. Well, that's a, that helps right there.
Yeah. I mean, go ahead.
No, I was just, and that, you know, that's excluding, you know, naturally we know the state roads are, you know, the state road is 6A is takes away half of this, but, you know, like we said, so.
Yes. So just to address both of those. So 6A, if we start on the very east end, we're all familiar with the flooding that takes place at the town line with Brewster and Airline Road.
Yeah.
That's a major one that floods all the time. Continuing west from there, once we get past 134 and past the Grumpies, you know, we have that area there that floods that's associated with Stewart Creek. So MassDOT is working on replacing those culvert crossings there, which I think is going to help the flow through there. It's not going to help the lowness of the road. So those are the two big areas on 6A. Is there anything to the west on 6A as you get out towards Captain Frosty's that anybody is familiar with?
No.
No, okay.
It's pretty high in there.
Yep. All right, so as far as Route 28, again, let's start at the very east section in Dennisport. That section that's down by the shoe mark, where that pull-off road is, has anybody seen that flood? Because that was listed on here as well. Has anybody seen that flood?
No.
You know, okay, so if we continue west and we get past the fire station, we get to Hummingbird Gardens there at the very end of Weir Creek. Has anybody seen that flood? Because that was listed on here as well.
Well, other than the history of previous storms, but I personally in my 65 years hasn't seen it.
Okay. Have you seen any flooding up at the Bass River Park?
Yes.
You have, okay. Yeah. All right, so as far as immediate, I'm not saying long-term, we don't have to deal with it, but so that's, as far as the state roads go, those are the locations that I'm aware of. So with Bass River Park, we are working on designing that section of Route 28 currently. So we can certainly take that into consideration and knock the Bass River Park section off. So other than that, Hummingbird Gardens and over by the Schumart or wherever that pull-off road is there, that where the wetland goes through. I've never seen any flooding on either one of those areas. So I wouldn't necessarily put that section of Route 28 on a priority list. So to me, I think we can, you know, maybe put Route 28 on hold, go from there and maybe concentrate on 6A if we're gonna deal with the state. And I think at that point, where I think we're talking about Airline Road, but now we're talking about a very big area of road that is just very low. So I'm not sure what ability we would have to fix that without raising, you know, say 800-900 feet of road, maybe 1,000 feet of road. And that would include sections of Airline and School Street.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that would be a really big project. I certainly think it needs it, but.
I do too. It isolates an entire group of people. I mean,
yeah,
and they're year-round people.
I know, and it's such a large detour to get them around there when it does get closed down. It's right. Really inconvenient. So I think it's a priority location. That don't get me wrong. I think we should fix it and work with the state. But I don't know if there's an easy fix to fix it. But yeah, I think that should be on the list. So that list that I think I included G on the first list there. So, DPW, I know there's some good knowledge in that conference room there. Does anybody else have anything you want to
speak
say
up?
Go ahead. You're unmuted. Lower County Road.
Lower County Road.
Well, was it Lower County at South Street, the culvert there?
Yeah.
And then the bridge at the fish market at Swan River would be two locations to consider.
So are those on, were they on our map? Maybe we should just pop back to the map. Joe, if you can navigate there.
I'm part of Weir Creek.
Yeah, Lower County Weir Creek.
Okay, so C was on our list. So if we want to work east from Weir Creek, how many other locations? Are you talking about the Swan River Bridge?
So I know the condition of that bridge is not great. We did do a study on it, and it was better than we thought, but we've done some work there. I think one of the biggest issues that we have is that we have these culverts and bridges in place, but when they get overtaken by flood water, when that water recedes, it causes damage to the infrastructure. So we're constantly going back, having to pull back up loose stone material out of the culvert pipes, fabric that's blocked them. And, you know, I think that should be a consideration in the study is, you know, some of these areas you can't stop the water, but maybe controlling the damage or mitigating the damage that it does to the infrastructure. So that should
be. Yeah, that's a great point.
Yeah.
All right, so when we look at the Lower County at Weir Creek, both of those black areas right there on Lower County Road are somewhat hydraulically connected, and they both have culverts that are undersized culverts. So the area to the north is the area that we were talking about possibly doing a salt marsh restoration, which would probably take a look at both of those crossings there, but that's certainly something that we can take a look at.
Mm.
If you want to continue east on Lower County, so the next section is where the Swan Pond River crosses. So that's the bridge right there that the DPW was just talking about, that we're having some structural issues with that. So that is one of the bridges that I'm working with a consultant to give us a long range plan to replace that bridge. So certainly that should be include sea level rise and all that as well. Moving further east, guys, down by the Clancy's, is there an issue down?
That's, I don't know if that's more roadway flooding, but
yep.
If you go to Baker's Way in South Village, I mean, that area, I've now added that to our list of flood locations for putting out barrels, because that road will be, you know, you wouldn't be able to cross it because the culverts are undersized.
Yep.
And the whole area is so low-lying that it just overtakes everything. So you're talking about a huge drainage system starting up near Sunset Lane off Trotting Park that's draining that whole area through culvert pipes. Some of them are even through people's yards with easements, and it is town infrastructure. It's not private, even though it's on private property.
The culverts are seriously undersized.
Heard Trotting Lane. Am I in the right spot here?
Yes. Yeah, if you zoom out a little bit, Joe. If you zoom into that area right there between Swan River and Uncle Stephen's Pond. So if you can show a little bit more to the east.
So that whole wetland north of Lower County there between Trotting Park and South Village, that drains through a culvert there.
Yep.
And that culvert is almost entirely underground, going through a private street and then in between houses. comes out into the next wetland area, and then goes through another culvert at the town owned parking area, and then another culvert under South Village, and another one under Baker's Way, and then it has issues with sand migration blocking the end of it. So it's something you can fix, but getting it to drain better, you know, you're not going to stop the water from going in it, but making it drain better. Yeah, and again, we just have so many of these culverts that are undersized, so when the water gets backed up behind them, it causes erosion issues around the street, and we're constantly having to go back and fix it.
There's a culvert somewhere under here?
No, it goes from where you are right now.
At Fiddler's Green and the other road, dirt road there, there's one that goes through that neighborhood. In between the houses.
Yep, right through there. Okay. Yep, keep going. Right there. Yep. Right through there. Right through there. Right through there. Yep.
Got it.
Yep. Then it also goes north under Lower County up to that whole wetland.
So one thing before we go that I should show you all, I know that we're all furiously taking notes on your great comments. But there's also the ability to drop a pin on this tool and make a comment. So okay. If you turn on, if there's something that you think of later or you think we need to look at, if you turn on either of these comments for coastal flooding or for coastal erosion, and then go to this edit box, you can select either of them. And then click on the point where you want to make the comment. And there's a couple questions that pop up. Okay. Answer those to whatever extent you want. But that could also be a good way to communicate and also get some public feedback.
Yeah, that's good. And again, even in yesterday's high tide, that there's see the parking lot that's down where that big black boot looking area is there, it kind of. Yeah, that parking lot right there was completely underwater yesterday.
Mm. Wow.
That's just a monthly high tide.
Wow. Yeah. Yes.
I agree with Tom that the Ware Creek near Lighthouse Inn, and then the New Boston and Beach Street. All those are subject to the water overtaking the road and causing damage to the infrastructure there. So I think, I don't know what you guys think, but that's kind of where I see the focus going towards.
I think this has been a really productive conversation. Each town has been different. So, it's interesting for us as well, but I hope for you, this conversation has helped to sort of coalesce some agreement around certain roads. And Tom, thank you for leading the charge and identifying that first cut. I'm just going to share one last slide. Just to review next steps with you all, and then we'll send you all on your way. We've mostly talked about this throughout the workshop, but just to sort of wrap things up. So, over the next month or so, we're available to help the town identify two road segments that you'd like to see carried forward for some additional analysis and solutions identification. You can use the viewer, use the comment tool that Joe just pointed out. You can provide comments to me directly if you'd like, or to Joe. We'll be in touch to help you come to some agreement about what those road segments are. If you'd like to meet as a group separately, I'm happy to do that. once those road segments are identified, we'll send them off to Woods Hole Group and they'll work to do some feasibility analysis and identify some potential solutions and some potential costs to, so that ultimately the town will have some resources to help make a decision about how they want to move forward with addressing that, those particular problems. And we are in the process of updating our webpage on this project. We hope to have all the resources for each workshop in each community compiled in one location, so that you should have access to our slide deck today. There will be another link to the viewer, a recording of this session as well. And other resources will be posted there as they are developed. Later on, the solutions that are, have been identified will be located there as well. So I'll just stop there, see if there are any final questions. And if not, just really thank all of you for attending this morning, taking the time to do this. Participating, I really appreciate your engagement and feedback, and also thank the rest of the commission team who've been working on this, and especially Joe Famley and others at Woods Hole Group who've been working furiously to get this work done. And Tom, I see your hand is up. Last words.
Yeah, no, I was just going to reiterate what you said. I appreciate all of the Cape Cod Commission and Woods Hole Group, and Joe putting together all this effort. I know there's a lot of work that went into this, and this is very helpful. Commission is always there to help us move forward there. And of course, selfishly, we're looking for you know, things to identify to hopefully get some funding to help us go through too. So I think that's, you know, the other part of our thought process here. But thank you so much, and to all the town employees that did get on the line and join. Thank you for being part of it.
Great. Thank you so much. Yeah, thank you.